Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture on corticosteroids with me, Sanjay Dekhil. So you all have heard about corticosteroids in many places, read about them, but nevertheless, we might not have dealt with corticosteroids as a single topic. So here today, we are going to talk about corticosteroids. Let us have a look at the different things that we'll be discussing today. So this is the overview of the topic that we'll be discussing today, right? We'll be starting with corticosteroids as to what they are, the steroids. And when we say corticosteroids, it generally is used to refer to glucocorticoids. So we'll focus on glucocorticoids. We'll move on to talk about the different kinds of corticosteroids that are secreted in our body, the negative feedback mechanisms, the mechanism of action. And then we'll talk about the physiologic effects and the various effects of the glucocorticoids. Then we'll move on to talk about the clinical uses in brief and the toxicity, the various dosage forms of corticosteroids that are available. However, it would be only in the second lecture of corticosteroids that where we'll be talking about the corticosteroids that are used in therapy, right? Or elaborating the uses of corticosteroids in much more detail. Okay, so let us start with our lecture for today, corticosteroids. Corticosteroids are a class of steroidal hormones. They are released from the adrenal cortex and they include both glucocorticoids and mineralocorticoids. However, the term corticosteroids is generally used to refer to glucocorticoids. And again, the name glucocorticoids has come for the effect in carbohydrate metabolism. Glucocorticoids, in fact, they have got their roles in metabolism of not just carbohydrate, but also fat and proteins, right? But nevertheless, the effect on carbohydrate metabolism was identified first, hence the name glucocorticoids. So we've used the term steroid, right, out here. So a steroid, it's a group of compounds which has got a common structure based on a steroidal nucleus. The steroidal nucleus is called cyclopentanoyl porhydrophenanthrene ring. And the sex hormones and the hormones of the adrenal cortex, they are all steroids. The chart given out here is the chart for negative feedback loop. We'll be discussing about it shortly. Okay, glucocorticoids are the primary stress hormones that regulate a variety of physiologic processes and are essential for life. The action of glucocorticoids are predominantly mediated through glucocorticoid receptor. A diverse collection of receptor isoforms have been identified, and glucocorticoids they have been known to regulate diverse cellular functions like development, homeostasis, metabolism, cognition, and inflammation. Glucocorticoids, whether it is cortisol in man or corticosterone in rodents, they are the steroidal hormones that are synthesized and released from the adrenal glands in circadian manner and in response to physiological cues and stress. When we say circadian manner, it refers to the diurnal patterns, right? So glucocorticoids, they are expressed during the morning hours, and the level of glucocorticoids is highest at around 8 a.m. in the morning. So the secretion of the glucocorticoids starts early morning and then it peaks in the morning hour at around 8 a.m. Due to the lipophilic nature of the glucocorticoids, they cannot be pre-synthesized and stored in the adrenal glands like adrenaline and noradrenaline, right? So they have to be rapidly synthesized using a number of enzymatic reactions upon ACTH stimulation. The biologically active glucocorticoids are synthesized from cholesterol through a multi-enzyme process, and this process is termed steroidogenesis, or the genesis of the steroidal compounds. So this was all about the glucocorticoids, the introductory part, right? So let us have a look into how are glucocorticoids secreted and where are they secreted from. ACTH is secreted by the anterior pituitary under the influence of corticotropin-releasing hormone on hypothalamus. Then the adrenal cortex secretes several hormones. Zona glomerulosa secretes mineralocorticoids or the aldosterone. Zona fasciculata secretes glucocorticoids or cortisol. And zona reticularis secretes androgens or the sex hormones. So you can see out here, zona glomerulosa, zona fasciculata, zona reticularis is given out here, right? And this is the medulla. Okay. This falls under the biochemistry part, where it is shown that zona glomerulosa secretes aldosterone, zona fasciculata prepares and secretes cortisol, and zona reticularis secretes estrogen and testosterone. Right? And this all starts from the cholesterol molecule. Okay, let us talk about the negative feedback mechanism of corticosteroids. Glucocorticoids, they inhibit the ACTH secretion via direct and indirect actions on the CRH neurons so as to decrease the CRH mRNA levels and CRH release via direct effect on the corticotrophs. What happens is that at lower cortisol levels, the mineralocorticoid receptors are generally occupied, and the mineralocorticoid receptors are known to have higher affinity as compared to glucocorticoids than glucocorticoid receptors. The major receptor. Glucocorticoids are the major receptor species that are occupied by glucocorticoids. As the concentration of the glucocorticoid increases, they saturate the mineralocorticoid receptors, and the glucocorticoid receptors become increasingly occupied. Both the mineralocorticoid receptors and the glucocorticoid receptors apparently control the vessel activity of the hypothalamus pituitary axis, whereas the feedback inhibition of glucocorticoids is predominantly involved glucocorticoid receptors. In the pituitary, the glucocorticoids act through glucocorticoid receptors so as to inhibit the release of ACTH from corticotrophs and the expression of propylmelanocortin. Propylmelanocortin is a pituitary precursor of circulating melanocyte stimulating hormone or MSH, adrenal corticotropic hormone or ACTH, and beta endorphin. Okay, this chart shows the normal daily production rates and the circulation levels of predominant corticosteroids. If we look into the corticosteroids that are secreted, then the rate of secretion under the optimal conditions is 10 mg per day for cortisol and 0.125 mg per day for aldosterone. And as we talked earlier, the concentration in the peripheral plasma at 4 mg is 4 microgram per 100 ml and 0.01 microgram per 100 ml for cortisol and aldosterone. And this concentration increases for cortisol at 8 a.m. We see that the concentration reaches 16 microgram per 100 ml, whereas for aldosterone, the concentration remains the same, 0.1 microgram per 100 ml. And this is taken from Goodman and Gilman Pharmacology, 13th edition. You can see this at page number 849. Okay. The chart that is given out here, it shows the mechanism of action of corticosteroids. Right here, there are different terms called CBG, which stands for corticosteroid binding globulin. Okay, let us look at the mechanism of action in this picture, in the given picture out here. CBG stands for corticosteroid binding globulin, and this is the globulin which binds the maximum level of corticosteroids. Then the free form of a steroid is able to enter the cell. This is the free form of a steroid that enters the cell and then binds to its receptor, or right, the glucocorticoid receptor that we talked about. The glucocorticoid receptor normally has got heat shock proteins and immunofilings out there. Then on binding of the receptor to the steroid, it forms an unstable complex, and the heat shock proteins and the immunofilings, they get separated, whereby the dimerization of the receptor happens. The activated form, that is the steroid receptor dimer, it enters the nucleus and binds to the glucocorticoid response element, or GRE. This leads to the transcription of RNA. Free mRNA is formed in the nucleus, whereby in the cytoplasm, the mRNA is formed. This mRNA leads to protein formation and the ultimate response of the corticosteroid. Okay, let us have a look at the short form of the mechanism of action. The steroids, they penetrate the cell and bind to high affinity cytoplasmic receptor protein or large multiprotein complex. On binding ligand, the glucocorticoid receptor undergoes a conformational change, resulting in the dissociation of the multiprotein complex. The ligand-bound glucocorticoid receptor is rapidly translocated into the nucleus through the nuclear pores. Then there is binding to glucocorticoid response element on the chromatin. The transcription of specific mRNA and regulation of protein synthesis happens. The onset of all this thing takes at least around 30 to 60 minutes. However, the effect persists much longer than the steroid itself. In many tissues, the overall effect is catabolic, that is inhibition of protein synthesis, and this is thought to be a consequence of steroid-directed synthesis of inhibitory protein. Okay, let us have a look at the physiologic effects of the drug. The glucocorticoids have widespread effects because they influence the function of most of the cells of the body. The glucocorticoids, they stimulate the gluconeogenesis, and as a result, the blood glucose level rises, the muscle protein is catabolized, and insulin secretion is stimulated. Both lipolysis and lipogenesis are stimulated with a net increase of fat deposition in certain areas like fat and shoulders, back. Because of the deposition of the fat on the in the face, it leads to the moon face like structure that is often seen with Cushing syndrome or the overdosing of glucocorticoids. Also, the deposition of the fat in the shoulder and the back, it leads to the buffalo hump, which is a characteristic of Cushing syndrome. A major metabolic consequences of glucocorticoid secretion or administration is it is due to the direct action of these hormones in different cells. Also, many of the effects of glucocorticoids are dose related, and they become magnified when large amounts are administered for therapeutic purposes. There are also other effects that are known as permissive effects, and these effects refer to the effects without which the normal functions will become deficient. This is seen in case of vascular and bronchial smooth muscle to catecholamines. That is, the response is diminished in the absence of cortisol, and the response is seen again when physiological amount of glucocorticoids are restored. Similarly, the lipolytic response of the fat cells to catecholamine, ACTH, and growth hormone is attenuated in the absence of glucocorticoids. So that was about physiological effects. Now let us have a look at the catabolic effects. We said earlier that glucocorticoids form a kind of inhibitory protein, right? So it leads to catabolic effects. The glucocorticoids are known to have important dose-related effects on catabolism, as on carbohydrate, protein, and fat metabolism. Glucocorticoids cause muscle protein catabolism. In addition, lymphoid and connective tissue, skin and fat, they undergo wasting under the influence of high concentrations of steroids. The catabolic effect on the bone can lead to osteoporosis. The glucocorticoids, they are known to increase the serum glucose level and stimulate the insulin release. But they also, side by side, inhibit the uptake of the glucose by the muscle cells and stimulate the hormone-sensitive lipase, thus lipolysis. The increased insulin secretion stimulates lipogenesis and, to a lesser extent, inhibits lipolysis. It leads to a net increase in the fat deposition combined with increased fatty acids and glycerol in the circulation. Coupled with catabolic effects are the anti-anabolic effects. So although glucocorticoids, they stimulate RNA and protein synthesis in the liver, they have got ultimate catabolic and anti-anabolic effects in the lymphoid and connective tissue, muscle, peripheral fat, and skin. The superphysiologic amounts of glucocorticoids, they lead to decreased muscle mass and weakness, thinning of the skin. All these things are seen in the side effects of the glucocorticoids later. The catabolic and the anti-anabolic effects of the bone are the cause of osteoporosis during the Cushing syndrome. In children, the glucocorticoids are known to reduce the depth, reduce growth. This effect may be partially reversed by the administration of growth hormone. And when the growth hormone are given in high doses, the stunting effect of the glucocorticoids on children can be reversed, but then the use of growth hormone is generally not recommended. And then it is said that in case inhalation form of glucocorticoids that are used in asthma, the stunting of the growth in children is short term and it does not affect the overall height of the children in the long term. So that was about the catabolic and anti-anabolic effects. Let us have a look at the immunosuppressive effects. The glucocorticoids inhibit the cell-mediated immunology functions, especially those that are dependent on the lymphocytes. They are actively lymphotoxic, so they are important in case of hematologic cancers. The drugs do not interfere with the development of normal acquired immunity, but they are known to delay the rejection reactions in patients with organ transplants. Hence, their use in organ transplants is relatively higher. Now, let us have a look at the anti-inflammatory effects. The glucocorticoids have dramatic suppressive effects on numerous inflammatory processes. These drugs increase the neutrophils and decrease the lymphocytes, eosinophils, basophils, and monocytes. The migration of the leukocytes is also inhibited. The biochemical mechanisms that underlie the cellular effects include increase synthesis of A beta for phosphorylase A2, decrease mRNA for cyclooxygenase 2, decreases in interleukin 2 and 3, decreases in platelet activity factor, which is an inflammatory cytokine. So that was about the immunosuppressive and the anti-inflammatory effects. Let us have a look at other effects. Glucocorticoids such as cortisol are required for normal renal excretion of water loads. The they also have effects on the CNS. When they are given in large dose, they have profound behavioral changes, and the large doses also stimulate gastric acid secretion and decrease resistance to ulcer formation. The glucocorticoids are important for fetal lung development as well. That's why they are often supplemented in case of preterm delivery before. The glucocorticoids are also important for fetal lung development, that is the surfactant production in the fetal lung. And it often happens that with in case of preterm delivery, 24 weeks to 36 weeks, there is a chance of fetal lung collapse because of inadequate surfactant production. Therefore, glucocorticoids are supplemented to the pregnant mother before delivery. And it is tried that the delivery is postponed by at least 24 to 48 hours for adequate production of the surfactant in the fetal lungs. Now, let us look at the clinical uses. They are used in various adrenal disorders. Glucocorticoids are essential to preserve the life of patients in chronic adrenal cortical insufficiency, that is Addison's disease, and they are necessary in acute adrenal insufficiency that are associated with life-threatening shock, infection, or trauma. They are also used in certain types of congenital adrenal hyperplasia, in which synthesis of abnormal forms of corticosteroids are stimulated by ACTH. In this condition, the administration of potent synthetic glucocorticoid suppresses the ACTH secretion sufficiently so as to reduce the synthesis of abnormal steroids. And this happens through the negative feedback mechanism, which we discussed earlier. So they are also used for various non-renal disorders, right? Many disorders, they respond to corticosteroid therapy, and some of them are inflammatory and immunologic in nature, like asthma, organ transplant reaction, collagen disease, rheumatic disease. In all these cases, steroids are useful. They are also useful in other cases like hematopoietic cancers, neurologic disorders, chemotherapy-induced vomiting, hypercalcemia, mountain sickness, and surfactant production in preterm infant, which we just discussed earlier. We'll be talking about clinical uses in our next lecture on corticosteroids. So have a look at this chart. It talks about the toxicity of the corticosteroids. You see that the toxicity picture is very much similar to that of Cushing syndrome, right? The toxicity of glucocorticoids are also seen when glucocorticoids are given in excess. So whether it is overproduction or it is giving the glucocorticoids externally in excess, they both produce similar kind of symptoms. So euphoria could be there, right? Similarly, buffalo hump, hypertension, thinning of skin, and coupled with thinning of the skin, there may be poor wound healing and easy bruising as well. Thin arms and legs as a result of muscle wasting and negative nitrogen balance. Then there may be benign intracranial hypertension, cataracts, moon face with red plethoric cheeks, again increased abdominal fat, and avascular necrosis of the femoral hair. Apart from that, there may be osteoporosis, tendency to hyperglycemia, negative nitrogen balance, increased appetite, increased susceptibility to infection, and obesity. Though we talked about various side effects of the drug, right? But the short-term therapy is generally well tolerated. There's no problem with short-term therapy, but longer courses can cause serious toxicity. So most of the time, glucocorticoids, they are tried for short-term use as compared to long-term use. Sometimes the toxicity can be life-threatening and can include metabolic effects like growth inhibition, diabetes, muscle wasting, osteoporosis. Again, it can cause salt retention, reduced wound healing, and psychosis as well. So as to avoid adrenal insufficiency in patients who have had long-term therapy, additional stress doses may need to be given during serious illness or before major surgery. The patients who are being withdrawn from glucocorticoids after prolonged treatment, their doses should be tapered slowly over a course of several months to allow recovery of normal renal adrenal function. That was about toxicity. In order to avoid the unwanted effects of corticosteroids, there are certain things that can be done, right? One is modification of dose or dose regimen, like use short courses or low doses if possible. Use steroid sparing drug and use other drugs where possible. Would rather chronic steroids slowly or taper the steroids. Give the dose once daily and in the morning. Give the dose on alternate days if possible. Give prophylactics if possible. Give the product locally and remember contraindications. However, even when we give the product locally, there can be certain problems like systemic dosing can occur and local toxicity can develop at different sites. Like in the skin, it can lead to infection, thinning and bruising. When given in the eye, it can lead to viral infection, cataract or glaucoma. When given as an inhalation in asthma and COPD, it can lead to fungal infection and hoarseness. And when given intra-articularly, locally in the joints, then it can lead to infection and necrosis. So far, we have not been talking about individual drugs, right? So here is the list of different drugs. The anti-inflammatory potency, sodium retaining potency, and the duration of action, as well as the equivalent dose of the drugs. So we see that hydrocortisone is taken as an example out here because this is something that is secreted in our body by the name, and we call it by the name cortisol. Right? So the anti-inflammatory potency and sodium retaining potency is 1-1 out here. However, the duration of action is short and the equivalent dose is 20 mg. So if you need to substitute hydrocortisone with methylprednisolone, then you see that the anti-inflammatory potency is 5, right? And sodium retaining potency is 0.5. So out here, the equivalent dose is only 4, in that this is 5 times more potent as compared to hydrocortisone. So we are giving 4 mg as compared to 20 mg or in case of hydrocortisone. And the same is with other drugs as well. The most potent drugs that are given out here are betamethasone and dexamethasone, where the equivalent dose for hydrocortisone 20 mg is only 0.75 mg in both the drugs. Okay, have a look at this chart. We are well aware of beclomethasone, betamethasone, budesonide, cyclosonide, clobetasol, dexamethasone, fluticasone. So there are different drugs. You don't need to remember the names of all the drugs, right? But nevertheless, you might need to remember as to which one is topical, which one is nasal for some examples. And there are other examples as well, right? As I said earlier, we'll also be talking about individual drugs and their uses in our next lecture. So that's all for today. Thank you. If you have any queries, let me know in the comment section below. That's all. Have a nice day.